Hi, folks. My name is Dave Woodard. Yes, I am the man that stole the grave marker that was at Cimarron Canyon. So I'm making a public apology right now. I'm putting it right out there to apologize to everyone that I've upset. I apologize that was very bad of me to take that grave marker. And people are upset over it. So this right here, from my heart, I'm apologizing to the world for taking that grave marker or having my friends grab it. Very disrespectful. So the reason I took it was a misunderstanding, apparently, of Forrest Fenn's treasure hunt. In my solve in Forrest Fenn's treasure hunt, it led me directly to that cross. So in turn, I believed that that cross was what Forrest Fenn left for somebody to find the actual final resting place of the treasure. So my apologies. I hope everyone accepts them. I didn't mean to hurt anyone's feelings. And I put it right out there. It was my idea to take that. And I apologize. So, what I want to do to make it up to you is just explain why I took that cross. Now, that cross had the name Kent and Esther on it. I'm not sure who Kent and Esther were. If it was... Now, a grave marker is different than just a marker or just a cross. If it's just a cross and there's... I don't believe anybody was buried at Palisades Sill parking area. So this cross that has Kent and Esther in it, it only made a connection to me, as I said, in the Forrest Fenn solve. So now that I've apologized, as I said, I would like to just explain Kent and Esther, why I assumed that that was a connection with Forrest Fenn. Because as I sat there in the parking lot and I saw the cross and saw the names, in my head, in Forrest Fenn's solve, he says, if you can't figure out the first clue, you might as well stay home and play canasta. Well, in my solve, and I'm not going to bring up the whole solve to get how I get there. I pretty much basically want to explain the cross, the Kent and Esther. But how you get there is the first clue that I figured out for the map. He's pinpointing and telling you Palisades Sill. So if you can't figure out that first clue where he's pinpointing to Palisades Sill, then I don't believe anybody would have solved the poem. So that was only my interpretation of it. So now, stating that the first clue in my solve is Palisades Sill, the first stanza, the first four lines, he's pinpointing Palisades Sill. That's why I assumed that the cross was Forrest Fenn's. So, now that you know, if you can't figure out the first clue, you might as well stay home and play canasta. That Kent and Esther, to me, Forrest talked about how important the grave marker was to him from Vietnam. So, I assumed that that grave marker might have some significance. So the Kent and Esther, I drove up to the Vietnam War veteran place up towards Eagle's Nest in Angel Fire, and I looked for the names Kent or Esther through a lot of the markers there and the grave markers and all the memorials, and I didn't find anything. So, but sitting in front of it, I realized Forrest had mentioned about how important that grave marker was, and when it came back into his life, how he melded the thoughts together. And it was the Philadelphia caper when he was in his airplane and getting a little loopy. That's when he came up with the idea to blend. He said meld. Meld is when you blend together. Now, word was the closest person to the treasure chest had an androgynous name. Androgynous is partly male and partly female. So, that being said, if you meld those thoughts together from the grave marker as it entered into his life later in years again, like he mentions, I took Kent and Esther and I gave Kent his nickname, Ken, and Esther, and I joined them together. And I came up with Ken Esther. You might as well stay home and play canasta. So I misunderstood and took it for granted that that was his cross. Not realizing, until I started investigating a little bit more, that that name, Kent and Esther, I had no idea who those people were. So the canasta, though, if you look up J.D. Solinger, J.D. Solinger was a canasta fiend. He loved playing canasta. And Forrest Fenn mentions J.D. Solinger towards the beginning of the book, a few times. And if you look up the northern terminology for a really, really bad hand in canasta, is as dead as canasta. That is your terminology for a really bad hand. As dead as canasta. So, looking at the cross, realizing that you meld the names together into canasta, they are as dead as canasta. That's how I took it. So, I was wrong, right? So, that being out of the way, the J.D. Solinger, as dead as canasta, that made sense to me. It doesn't make sense to the Fenn community. I apologize to all of you. So, moving on to the next step of that. Okay, if you take Kent and Esther, put them together, canasta, in his book, he said two people can keep a secret if one of them is dead. He also mentioned this at the Mysterious Books store in one of the interviews. Now, I never understood that terminology as far as if two people can keep a secret if one of them is dead. If you have two separate people, one of them is dead, the other one still can let the secret out there. But if you have two people and you meld them together, now two people can keep a secret if one of them is dead. Because if one of them is dead, they're both dead. That's how that terminology comes in to me. Apparently, it doesn't come in to the Fenn community. I apologize to you that you don't understand that. And all the other things, the bad things I've done. So that connection, nobody has ever told me what that means in their solve. To me, in this solve that I came up with, the terminology, two people can keep a secret if one of them is dead, is if Kent or Esther are dead, they are canasta, they're both dead, they're going to keep the secret. That's how I came up with that. So, to me, in my head, it works a little different than a few of the Fenn community. I saw that as a great clue. I thought that was like, wow, that is huge. Apparently, I must be wrong. So, I apologize, as I said, for that. Now, moving on from the two people keeping a secret, if one of them is dead, you kind of move on to who actually Kent and Esther are. Now, that grave marker that Forrest Fenn talked about, if you should ever pass my veil, smile and think of me and smile at a homely girl. So the first thing I came up with, after knowing the names and realizing who's a homely girl, who's been called ugly, who's been called whatever, trying to figure out these clues that Forrest supposedly put out there, my interpretation of it, which I finally came up with, and it took a while, but I finally came up with Aunt Esther from Sanford and Son, and how many times that Forrest used to call her so ugly, they made gorilla cookies out of your face. He picked on her every single show. He would call her ugly or her family ugly. And as far as I'm concerned, Esther on the cross is Aunt Esther, the homely girl. It lined up for me. Apparently, the Fenn community does not agree with me. I apologize that you don't agree with me. So, after I figured that out, I thought that was great. That's amazing. He's pulling in a TV show of somebody who's important to him, made him laugh when he was younger. If you look through the books, in my own opinion, and I gave Barbara Anderson some kudos for this because there's a lot, a real lot of all different. If you look through the books, you will see many, many, many correlations with TV shows, old radio shows, movies, all kinds of things that he brings in that were important to him, that he grew up with, part of his life, that meant a lot, that he thought about and made sense. So I was wrong about Aunt Esther. I apologize. It seemed like it made sense to me. It was very, very, very important for him to bring in the grave marker, somehow incorporate it into his treasure hunt. Esther as a connection with the homely girl. Now, talking about Sanford and Son, he has a story about Fred. Now, there's Fred Sanford that ends up going in Fred Ferd in the third book. I figured that was Fred Sanford because in the other book, the second book, he talks about I don't remember if it was the first book or the second book, about the bells. And he said, if you die with more than $50 in your pocket, you're a failure. Well, Fred Sanford died completely, completely broke. And Eddie Murphy paid for his funeral, and Eddie Murphy paid for his headstone. So the connection there seemed really intense for Fred Sanford. He was talking about bringing him in, like that's how he brought him in. But Aunt Esther was the homely girl on the cross. And again, apparently I was wrong. And I apologize for that. So moving on from Esther, who I thought was on the cross, that Forrest Fenn brought all these clues in. Well, let's move on to Kent. Kent took me a little while to try to figure out, in my own opinion. And this is all the I'm letting you folks know, all the mistakes I made. And I'm not the solver, because all of these things don't line up at all, according to the Fenn community. So I want to apologize to all of the Fenn community. But the rest of you who are listening to these words, I don't need to apologize to you. If I offended you by moving the cross, I apologize to you. But as far as the clues, I'll let that slide. So Kent on the cross, it took me a while to figure it out, but it finally came to me who Kent was on the cross, because I started scanning the books again. And this is over 5-6 years of studying every day, just about different times, reading the books, taking them to work, reading them at the prison towers and in housing units. I would study, I would look up information. So Kent, I was scanning through the book and I noticed a story that said looking for Lewis and Clark, the old explorers. Now, Lewis and Clark, the story he tells, it's not really they were out looking for Lewis and Clark. They weren't looking for their trail. They weren't doing anything about Lewis and Clark. They were actually on an adventure because he read Russell Osborne, Diary of a Trapper. That is why they went out. But he called the story looking for Lewis and Clark. I interpreted that as though you are literally supposed to be out looking for Lewis and Clark? No, you're supposed to look for Lois and Clark. And you know who Lois and Clark are, right? Lois and Clark is from another TV show that was very important to Forrest Fenn. And I interpreted the third book, which I never got it. I thought I solved everything from the first two books. But so I didn't know what was in the third book, but looking for Lewis and Clark, he also brings up the Hulk in the first book, a Hulk of a guy. These superhero names, Beowulf is another superhero. Bessie, if you look up the word Bessie, she's somebody that can throw a punch like Superman. All of these superheroes that he brings up in his stories, they're all connected. But I'm wrong about it because I didn't solve it. Somebody else solved it somewhere else. So I apologize that people don't understand my soul. And I may seem like I'm sarcastic, but I really feel bad that these people are upset. So all the superheroes, when I finally realized that Lewis and Clark was looking, you're supposed to look for Lois and Clark. Clark Kent. Kent is what is on the cross with Aunt Esther. So if you join them together, and there's another story that actually, when you combine those names or when you figure out who those names are, there's a story where he says, step on a crack, break your mother's back. That way back used to be step on a crack and your baby will turn black. It was a very racial comment, but he brings it in his stories. And so I believe if you look up that thing, it's about interracial couples. So the people on the cross, Clark Kent and Aunt Esther, Clark is white, Aunt Esther is black. That's your interracial couple in the book. That's how I came up with that. That was a hint, a clue that pulled it together for me. So that being out of the way, which, and again, I'm only explaining why I interpreted that cross just to be something Forrest Fenn left for the actual solver to realize the connections that pull this all together. So I don't think I'm going to post any pictures. I might not. just so you understand how wrong my solve is. Okay? So the Kent and Esther, it's Clark Kent and Aunt Esther. We've established that. You join them together because the closest person to the treasure chest has an androgynous name. So, androgynous is partly male and partly female. When you take Kent and Esther and you join them together, you have an androgynous person. That is the closest person to the treasure chest. So, that being said, you have your androgynous name. That's how I misunderstood the whole solve and didn't solve that cross. See, folks, in my heart, I don't believe that was a real cross with two people buried there 12 feet in from the parking lot of Palisades Sill. I don't believe it was two little shih tzus that got run over by somebody in the parking lot and they buried him on the side of the parking lot. This overflow parking area is where I came up with, and that parking lot is Terry Scant. I won't bring in the poem. I won't bring in the actual map, the solve. But when you realize what really happened here and how this cross is so critical for Forrest Fenn's solve and his solution, that might end up letting you know that there is a real solve out there. Again, as I said, I had the first book, I had the second book, and only a few months ago, I finally received the third book. And for me, I needed to look up things because of what I knew for a solve on that cross. I wanted to look up to see if there were any superheroes in the third book. There's over 4, 5, 6 pages of Captain America and the other superheroes he talks about in the Funny Books story. So that solidified it to me. Now, another thing I looked up, because I knew Pleiades is a constellation, but Pleiades is almost spelled exactly like Palisades. So Palisades Sill, I thought, I'm going to look up in the third book and see if there's anything that maybe the spelling is misspelled. In one part of the book, he says, I misspell words all the time on purpose. So Pleiades, if you look up that story of the actual constellation, he talks about a secluded parking area. And then he goes into the next page, which is a big full page of the Pleiades, of the Small Dipper. He says a row of trees, which is in fact a palisade, which is Palisade Sill. So to me, that really solidified saying, okay. And the mixed up words between Pleiades and Palisade. In the stories, when he talks about Fred, he also says Fred, Ferd. He mixes up the words. He mixes up the letters in those things. So there's so many different connections that I came up with, and I am completely wrong about the whole solve, according to the Fenn community. So all those things that I got wrong about the connections, how it all pulls together, even after the whole map and everything else that brought me directly to that cross, precisely as Forrest said, to that cross. From that point on is when you realize what else you have to figure out to make that connection. And he knew that somebody could figure it out before they went out if they knew that they were looking for a cross with certain names on it. It would be really tricky, but to know you have to meld together those thoughts of the cross, that, like he says when he was in the airplane, it's so creatively beautiful and genius, as I've been trying to tell people. In my own head, I feel I'm correct on myself, on the cross, that Forrest Fenn left that cross there. And he left that cross at the parking lot just so an 80-year-old person would be able to find the treasure chest. Because if you went out with an 80-year-old person to look for the treasure chest, Forrest said, don't go anywhere an 80-year-old man wouldn't go. The blaze is 500 feet up. The old man's not going to make it up there, or the old lady. The 80-year-old person is not going to get to that point. But they still have a chance to solve the treasure hunt by looking at that cross that's 12 feet away from you in the parking lot that you can see. In my other videos, you can see the cross. And I will put a picture, I'm sure I'll put a picture up of the cross so you know the grave marker that I removed. So I apologize to the world. I apologize to the Fenn community that I removed that grave marker. It has since been put back, so you don't have to worry about it. But that's a critical, critical point of where the actual factual treasure was lying, in my own opinion. So, my apologies to the world. My apologies to the Fenn community. My apologies to Kent and Esther's family, wherever they may be. And if somebody knows who Kent and Esther are, please let me know. I do have a picture I'll put up that I put a separate set of flowers as respectful for Kent and Esther on there. That's up there from 2019. So I can show you that I was respectful by placing, the cross was still there, but I placed a thing of flowers along the grave and the circle of rocks that is significant to the actual blaze that's 500 feet up. So folks, if that didn't make you happy about me apologizing, sometimes I get sarcastic or narcissistic or excited, and I'm trying not to be in this video. I'm just trying to explain how wrong I got everything in my solve. So please leave some comments. Hopefully I made you feel more at ease that I apologize for removing the cross, but my respectfulness, there was still those flowers that I put there for Kent and Esther, even though I knew what it really was. So folks, I hope you follow me. I hope you understood what I said, and I hope you accept my apologies. So, thank you very much for watching. Please have a safe and blessed night and a great weekend coming up. And follow me, subscribe. I have more videos that I will probably be doing about my adventures and my girlfriend's adventures and our travels. For those of you that may have a hunch that I might be the actual solver with all of the answers answered, especially with the two people can keep a secret if one of them is dead, and as dead as Canasta, and it's all so beautiful the way it all pulls in, and there's more. I have more that I've given, and I have more that I can give for answers for all that stuff that I think has a high possibility of being the actual solve. And the Fenn community, hopefully they start opening up their minds a little bit more. But folks, thank you so much for watching. Take care of yourselves. Give everybody in your family a hug. Wear a mask if they have COVID. And take care of yourselves. All right, thanks folks. Take care. Dave Woodard, the man from the East. Have a great night.
And all the girlies say I'm pretty fly for a white guy.